Hey there, welcome to Play Noggin. I'm Julian, your brain's player too. Who among us doesn't love dinosaurs? I'm seriously asking because if you don't like dinosaurs, then we can't be friends. Nothing captures our childhood imagination like a Tyrannosaurus or a Brontosaurus or a Stegosaurus or any of the million other Osauruses you had memorized when you were five. The good people at Studio Wildcard knew this, and they decided the responsible thing to do was let you keep them as pets. In their game, Ark, Survival Evolved. The game's premise is pretty much what it says on the tin. You have to survive on a mysterious island called Ark. The island is populated by, you guessed it, dinosaurs. But why stop there? Why not throw in some woolly mammoths and saber-toothed tigers? Heck, you can even come, dodo bird. All the world's extinct species seem to end up on Ark. Wait, should we be worried that humans are here? Is that some subtle commentary, Studio Wildcard? The game had been in early access since the Mesozoic era, but it finally released in summer of 2017. And now we can all experience the joy of having a faithful companion Tyrannosaurus. I named mine Rex. But for some of us, fossils in movies and video games just aren't enough. We still dream of the real thing. We want to hand-feed woolly mammoths at the zoo, or have a passenger pigeon poop on our windshield. We want to visit a park of some kind with dinosaurs from the Cretaceous, Triassic, and the, I always forget that third period. The point is, we want to see these extinct creatures we've heard so much about up close and in the flesh. Could the wondrous powers of science make that possible? We've actually already brought back a species from extinction. It wasn't anything as magnificent as a Triceratops or as magical as a Leopleurodon. It was a Pyrenean ibex, a species of goat that lived in the mountains of northern Spain. The very last one died in the year 2000 when it was crushed by a falling tree. Scientists were prepared for just such an occasion, and it saved samples of the ibex's DNA. In 2002, they injected specially prepared goat eggs with the ibex's DNA and gave it a little jolt of electricity to kickstart life. Once the embryos were dividing, they were implanted into surrogate mother goats. Almost all the pregnancies failed, except one. In July of 2003, a clone of the extinct Pyrenean ibex was born, resurrecting a species for the first time ever. 7 minutes later, the goat died, making history again as the first species to go extinct twice. While existence didn't work out for the Pyrenean ibex, it showed that de-extinction was possible. You just need three things: DNA, an egg, and a birthing mother. That means, for some species we see in Ark, there actually is a chance to bring them back. One species that scientists are working to resurrect is the woolly mammoth. At this very moment, there are cells that have mammoth DNA dividing in a petri dish at Harvard. Mammoths died out in the relatively recent past. While most of them went from tusk to dust about 10,000 years ago, a small population survived on an island in the Arctic Ocean until about 1650 BCE. For context, the pyramids of Giza were built about 1,000 years before that, so woolly mammoths and Egyptian pyramids coexisted at one point. As a bonus, since woolly mammoths lived in colder regions, many of them have been preserved in ice like giant furry popsicles. With their soft tissue intact, scientists have been able to recover substantial chunks of DNA. They haven't gotten one complete genome, though. DNA breaks down over time as it's exposed to enzymes, oxygen, water, and UV radiation. The more time that goes by, the more fragmented DNA becomes. So even when scientists uncover a 40,000-year-old specimen that looks perfectly preserved, they still have to piece together its DNA. And woolly mammoth's DNA is over 5 billion base pairs long. There might be a shortcut, though. Woolly mammoths do have a close living relative, the Asian elephant. So rather than trying to rebuild the entire genome, scientists can use gene editing techniques to splice some mammal mutations into elephant DNA. Then they could just artificially inseminate an Asian elephant with their hybrid mammophant and watch her confusion when she gives birth to a really fuzzy kid. De-extincting woolly mammoths would be pretty amazing. I mean, if someone got me a mammoth for my birthday, I wouldn't be mad about it. But come on, scientists, you know what we really want. Give us the dinosaur. Now, obviously, there's a glaring flaw trying to create little baby raptors the same way we'd make mammoths. Most reptiles don't give birth to live young, so the artificial insemination approach is out. That might be a good thing, since developing embryos need to receive hormone signals from the mother at specific times, so it might be simpler to just use an egg. But then, where does the egg come from? The only living relatives of any dinosaurs are birds, which are clearly a lot more different from dinosaurs than elephants are from mammoths. And even then, birds aren't related to just any dinosaurs. but specifically to theropods like the T-Rex. So if you wanted something else like a Stegosaurus, you'd have to make the DNA entirely from scratch. Amazingly, we have cloned organisms from synthesized DNA alone. Scientists have created bacteria DNA and transplanted it into another bacterium to create a new living cell. It's impressive, but the DNA they synthesized was only a million base pairs long, pretty short as DNA goes. Plus, bacteria don't keep their DNA in a nucleus, which makes transplanting it into an empty cell easier. Scientists are now working to create synthetic yeast cells, which have a nucleus, and they're probably a couple years from figuring that out. We're still a long, long way from making multicellular organisms like frogs or dogs or dinosaurs. But even if the technology existed to put dino DNA inside an empty cell and nurture it until it was an adorable killing machine, there's still one massive problem. We have no idea what dinosaur DNA looks like, because there's absolutely none left on Earth. Those dinosaur bones you see in museums don't have any DNA, because they're not actually bone, but mineral deposits that were made over millions of years as the bones decayed and water seeped in. They're more like stone than bone, no DNA there. And there's no chance of a mosquito preserved in amber holding onto a drop of DNA, because DNA decays. Scientists have calculated that even under the very best circumstances, a strand of DNA would be completely broken apart after 6.8 million years. Since the dinosaurs were wiped out 65 million years ago, there's no chance of any DNA surviving to today. No two base pairs would be intact, it would be utterly useless. So we have no starting point. We have no idea how to make dinosaur DNA. Maybe after years of work, we could cobble together something that looks like a dinosaur. But even then, we still disagree on some fundamentals of what dinosaurs were like. Did the T-Rex have scales or feathers or some mix of both? Was it a fearsome hunter or an overgrown scavenger? We just don't know. So whatever creature we create would be our best guess, but it wouldn't be exactly like the real thing. Plus, we've been so preoccupied with whether or not we could, we didn't stop to think if we should. Based on my experience getting a pet T-Rex in Ark, hell yeah we should. Hey, thanks for watching. Don't forget to click subscribe because these videos aren't going extinct. Dinosaurs came in all kinds of crazy shapes, but they're nothing compared to the creatures that live in the sea. To find out why the ocean makes fish look weird, check out our video on Subnautica here. And don't forget to keep on playing.